It's nice to see everybody here this evening. Thanks for coming out. It's nice to see some first years here. We just went through 5 days of first year reviews, and they have been grilled by the artists in residence. And it's really great to see everybody here, including the students and board members and community. So thanks for coming out. My name is Chris Scotts. I'm the director here at the Academy. And we have a very special guest with us tonight, and it is my honor and privilege to be able to introduce McArthur Binion as our distinguished alum for 2017. I had the great pleasure today, along with Bev Fishman, Michael Stone Richards, and Addie Langford, about having lunch with McArthur, and he was regaling us with many stories. They had great energy, and I know this evening is going to be a wonderful lecture conversation that will take place here in just a few moments. So McArthur, thank you for making it here from Chicago. McArthur was born in Macon, Mississippi, and lives and works in Chicago, Illinois. He was born on a cotton farm in rural Mississippi in 1946. McArthur is now one of the most vital and important voices in contemporary American art. He has spent 40 years creating uniquely autobiographical abstractions that blur the lines between modernism, abstract expressionism, and improvisation. To create these iconic paintings, McArthur collaged his highly personal markers of his identity, his birth certificate, identity cards, family photographs, and address books, into seemingly impersonal grids of oil stick, ink, and graphite. His paintings offer a really powerful meditation on the persistence of history and memory, revealing how personal meaning can emerge out of even the starkest and minimalist of forms. As of important note, McArthur was the first African-American to obtain an MFA from Cranbrook in 1973. If you look at McArthur's resume, he has an incredible list of solo and group exhibitions, and I am not going to list any of those except to note that we're excited to be able to announce that he is going to be represented in the 57th Venice Biennale this year, which is a huge honor. So for those of you who want to do more research, you can read about McArthur's work in Art Forum, Hyperallergic, Wall Street Journal, ArtNet, New City Art, and many other places. He has numerous catalogs on his work. This is a catalog that was published in 2015 by Black Dog Publishing in London, along with his gallery, Gallery DeLong. He also has publications by the Contemporary Art Museum in Houston in 2014 and the University of Maryland in 2011. He's in the permanent collections of many museums across the country, including the DIA here in Detroit, obviously the Cranbrook Museum of Art, as you can see his work upstairs, the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York, the Smithsonian, and the Whitney Museum of American Art. So it is my honor and privilege to introduce McArthur as a distinguished alum of 2017, and as a special treat, we have a certificate for McArthur this evening. So if you'd like to step forward, we'd like to honor you.
Thank you, Chris.
As the distinguished one. So I just want to set the evening up a little bit, what we have going on here. Laura Mott, our curator of contemporary art here at the museum, is going to give you an historical backdrop and conversation for the conversation that will take place with Dr. Michael Stone Richards and McArthur Binion. So next up is Laura Mott.
Well, thank you, everyone. This is such an amazing honor to be welcoming McArthur Binion back to Cranbrook and to have the opportunity to speak with him. He's going to begin our evening going through a select history of his painting practice and speaking in a more narrative form about examples of his work. And then to kind of complement this, we're going to be following with a conversation with between myself and Michael Stone Richards, who is a very celebrated and beloved figure of the Detroit community. He is a professor of critical studies at the College for Creative Studies, CCS. And this is going to be a great opportunity as well because MacArthur and Michael have had an opportunity for years to speak about MacArthur's work and have a wonderful friendship to build on. So without further ado, I want to welcome MacArthur Binion for his own talk. Thank you.
Thank you guys for coming out. It's like it's really, where should I put this? First of all, let's start with, I mean, this is a great honor and all that stuff, but one of the main reasons I accepted the honor is because I wanted to talk to students, because I remember I was sitting where you were 44 years ago, like wondering, like, how did this cat get up here? It's like, you know. So that feels funny, but I mean, I'm like here now. And I'm getting like paid for this, man. This is great. I love it. I love it, guys. But before we like start the formal stuff, like when I got an email from Chris, like asking me if I wanted the honor, and so the conversation started, I said yes, and that was what, September or something, it was something in the fall, and what I did, like when I'm working in the studio, by the way, I make my daughter's lunch every day at 6:30 for the school, and I hit the studio, I'm there from 7:30, and I work at 4 and 5, but that's an aside. While I'm working, I don't listen to music. There's no phone. I don't answer phones, as a lot of you probably know. But every now and then, once a week, once a week, I'll have a thought and I'll stop working and I'll write something down. And these are two thoughts I wrote down for the students at this school, and particularly the painters, because I'm prejudiced, I guess you call it. So I don't have my glasses. Here, I'll try this. This says CAA talk lecture. Okay. One. Extremely.
You need my glasses?
No. Okay, I can get it now. Extremely extremely disturbing. That schools and institutions, it has become totally acceptable that you can have a valid visual experience on a screen that is as large as a laptop. To me, that's the most dangerous, not dangerous, it's one of the most difficult things about art education today. And I taught until 2 years ago, and but like when I finished school there in 73, I taught for 2 years, and they were going to offer me tenure after third year. Instead of taking tenure, I quit the job. Like, it was like, you did what? But my whole point was that trying to figure out how to be a painter from the inside out. I mean, everyone, can see stuff in the world, and this gets me to the second thing I wrote. Back in September, the thinking that it's all about career career is cool, it can be lots of fun, but if you're not willing to do this for 60 plus years with only you as an audience, do something else. I mean, because it's just, it's like, You know, I mean, like for me, it's a very emotional point because, you know, I mean, I could have had a career early on and shit, pardon my French, but, you know, let me kind of go back because I wrote some things this morning, too. Like, you know, I said, Cranbrook allowed me to become an academic outlaw. Like, I was known in my school for being an academic outlaw. You know, no faculty meetings and all that stuff because, like, the way art education is set up today, they, well, not here because this is a special place that I wrote about here. I mean, they allowed me to become an academic outlaw. And I should say this, but it's probably some people that are artists in residency. I mean, I like this, and particularly Chris, that my thesis was a page long. I mean, because for me, it was like the work. That's my thesis. I mean, all the thinking about the work. And that gets me to another thing. My daughter, Stella, who's like 17, 18 years old, and she's finishing high school, and she's a really hot, like, activist poet, like, national alone, and she reminded me of some things that I've talked to her and my brother. Her brother is finishing Reed next month or May, and and she says, she left me a note outside of my door in the morning because I left at 6 o'clock, and she says, be sure to tell those students, smart ain't special no more. No. So for me, it's a very important point because, like, everybody's smart. All you have to do is have one of these things. So, you know, so I'm going to say that. So what I'm doing, I'm going to go through things and possibly that Michael and Lauren and I can talk about at a larger sense. So, and also, ask questions. I love questions. And that's what else I say in here. Yeah, that's about it. Oh, yeah. And I say, this piece here?
So this piece right here? I made this piece. I like to walk on my phone. I made this piece in the second floor studio over there. And while I was a student, this piece is now in the Whitney Museum of Art. You got it? You know? So.
And so my message was to the students, maybe you got it already, you know? So just work harder than anybody else. I mean, like for me, it's not rocket science and shit, but work harder than anyone else. You know, for me, it's a really important thing. And I say also, where do you get your juice from? It has to be self-created in order to resonate. You know, you got to figure out how to make something, how to be the only person that does what you do. Like, otherwise, go to law school. Sorry. Okay. Now, I the people that know me closely know that I got a ton of stories. I have a story about everybody in New York, practically, because I knew everybody. I'm a very social person, even though I couldn't talk, really. It was like, yo. There's some more stuff on here, but I think it's a little more complicated. And I just wanted to go through the slides one time. I'm going to just go through them, and then perhaps we can go through them again if you guys like. You probably tell, I don't talk to people, but like when I do talk, I can't stop. So I go through days and days. My family, four and a half years ago, like when I got the call from Kavi Gupta, because I was trained, I met Dan Flavin and Ronald Blaine here while I was a student. In fact, like James came to pick me up today, I came to pick up Ronnie Blaine and Dan Flavin. And we became friends. In fact, you know, that's how I got my first show in New York. But like I should meet them the first Monday of every month at Max's Kansas City. And if you guys know, some of you older people, or some of you are historians, because everybody knows everything because of the internet, you know, God. It's like, you know, like for me, still, I'm kind of furious. Like in my painting classes, I never showed slides. I would walk the students up from college where I was teaching at Columbia College, six blocks to the museum and see a piece. Because it's like, you know, like, fortunately, this is large scale. But these pieces were done at school, and they're called circuit landscapes. And you have to remember, it's very important in terms of work. In 73, there's a few things that were different than today, but you communicate with people three ways, basically, like eye to eye, telephone, or the United States mail. So, you know, you had to interact with people. You couldn't be this great giant star in your room for 5 years without leaving, you know? Because, you know, but yeah, anyways, I'm gonna show you, go through this, and the last image was prepared specifically for this, for the painting students. That was done here. The sizes, that's 94 inches square. The smallest student I ever had was here, and these are the largest paintings ever made. It's like totally wild. It's crazy, man. These are the aluminum, crown aluminum, and these were done just after the ones upstairs. And, you know, I told Laura something today that I hadn't really revealed it before. And pardon me, the head of the museum, what's your name? Andrew. So I told them that actually these were reused lithographic plates. So I was early reuse, you know. That's another one from the same time. This is circuit landscape number two. Number one is, I did two, and then the Michigan biennial. They should have sculpture 1 year and painting 1 year. Anyways, you know, I was very fortunate that this piece won the most outstanding painting award and is in some big collection in London. But that was done here. And that's a detail of that. Another circuit landscape, detail, circuit landscape, detail. Oh, I really should never have sold this one, Jesus. No, it's really wild. It's like, I showed these at Artist Space, and I was the second show. Carl Andre, Saul LeWitt, and Ronald Blaine chose Jonathan Borofsky, Mary Oberon, and me. And I would have sold, like, everything there, but they weren't stretched, and people were trying to get me to convince me to stretch it. But I said, no, I'm not changing the integrity of my work with some money. I mean, money's only money. So... why did I start that conversation? Anyways, that's it. No, I can tell you. What's that? Yeah, well, yeah. Is Glenn Manisto here? Oh, that's not. Glenn Manisto, because that previous painting that was in the Whitney was previously owned by him. And he received it, this is kind of personal, but I'm kind of, and he received it from Dirk Bacher. Like some people here know that, like the same thing. These are all done here. And this is my thesis show. It was part of it. This is a show called Ghost Rhythms. And I just wanted to show you guys this because there's a painting here called Ghost Rhythms that I did in 1975. It was like the first work. I was very fortunate to have a job where I moved to New York for $95 and a job in like 90 days. So, but I was very fortunate to be able to start to work in a major way pretty much right after I moved there. And I went to, there's a piece called Ghost Rhythms. It's for me the first piece that clearly is about the South. And that's 75. And the new work that I'm doing now is called Route 1, Box 1, which is the address of the house I was born in. And there were, you know, all of us born in there. And it's in black and white. And that's sort of like, I want to give you some kind of like hint about where the work is going. So we'll see this show here. This was a, forget this. So work here. Like the work from the something school and then the work about for the next 3 years. And it's really curious that, like what I did after the Artist Space show, and it was very well received. Here's a story for you. You guys know the restaurant in New York called the Four Seasons? It's a big time restaurant. The building was designed by Meese. The restaurant was designed by Philip Johnson. So I do the show at Artist Space. It was very well received. It was reviewed by Roberta Smith and all over. And while I'm, about a couple weeks later, I get a call from someone named David Whitney. David Whitney, and he asked me if I'd like to show the work for the spring, whole spring, at a restaurant called Four Seasons. I never heard of it. So I call my, big friends like David Novos, Price Meyer, and Joanna Pusa Dart and say, they say like, no. But the main thing, I didn't know who David Whitney was. David Whitney was, he's passed away, was a partner of Philip Johnson for 45 years. And he was huge, and I didn't even know it. But anyways, that story. But the point is that if I had shown at the Four Seasons, I would never have them. I would have been a totally different career. I'm really glad I took it the slow way. What else? This is called Ghost Rhythms. And it's done in 1975. It's all wax crayon. It's aluminum, crayon aluminum, and it's 48 high by 72 wide. And it's kind of like the first, like for me, the goal still is to really want to make a good painting, and I'm still working on that. And for me, that's a goal that I never want to go away because, I think it's just like it's really hard for me anyway, I think, to make a really good painting because there's so many paintings been done. And so to make something like, new or something like, it's just the hardest part of my life. Okay, then we're going to, and this is a work on paper from the same show, Ghost Rhythms. And then there's a close-up of the crayon on aluminum. See that? I own that one still, and I haven't fixed it yet. Okay, now this is like this is work from last year's called DNA Seasons, and I basically all I want to do is show the circuit landscapes and the seasons because it's like they're 40 some years apart. And they're so closely related. It's like, it's just more depth, it's more thinking, it's more. But I gotta tell you guys, if you have to have a lot of language, like people like I use names, this is crazy, but like Richard Prince and people like that, like those guys need a lot of language for the work. Like, because if you at least see the surface of the painting, it's not special at all. So, it's like, you have everything you need already. It's just really true. Because you're going to a really good school and they allow you to be, free and also crazy and stuff, if you want to be. And still get an MFA, See what I'm saying? It's just the way it is. Yeah, man. So I'm just getting warmed up, y'all. It's like we can go on for all night here, man. And also I work, like if you work every day, I work 335 days a year at the least, and work full days. If you work, you get work done. Like, so most artists, they do, you know, a work for show every 2 years, and the ones that are really ambitious, they do once every year. Like, where's Liz Bauer? Is Liz here? I do three. You know, so like, I'm really pushing it because I think that, like when you recognize that you're doing your best work, you better stay on it, because it's not gonna last. It just won't last. But I'm working like I was in the 1970s, man. It's like, it feels really good. I don't drink, I don't read anything, I don't listen to music. It's kind of like an exquisite boredom life. It's quite special, I think. And yeah, like those sizes are 7-foot squares. There's different sizes there, close up of that. That's a 72 by 96. The new work, I'm gonna go the biggest I've ever gone. I'm gonna do for the March show in the Long. I'm gonna do a 8 by 12. This is a painting that Laurie Barron loves. Laurie? Mark, you better get on it, baby. Yeah. There we go. Yeah, I'm gonna go through them fast, and we can go through more if you like. I mean, but I was telling you, like, I don't look at my work. I don't follow me. So, you know, because I think that once you start to, well, number one, I'll say one thing, and I love and know writers, and they're gonna be like, what is he saying? Like, once the conversation starts, oh, we got a mic here. Like, once the conversation starts about, when the conversation starts, you leave the painting. So, in one way for me, nothing written has anything to do with the work. I mean, that's probably the hardest thing to say, but it leaves the work. So, you know, and I think for me, that's a really valid question, and I think like, and also, let's say if you didn't have a computer or you didn't use it, you know, that's a problem that I would like to have, but I'm really glad I'm not 30 anymore. And I think I talked to Bev Fishman about this today. I was like, you know, that's a big problem for like our education anyways. But the point is that one, like, perhaps I would solve it by making my world small. Really small, so I could really, like, that could be mine. I could totally control all the imagery and all the, you know, the stuff, you know, the unsmart stuff. Because the smart stuff is easy to get. I think I'm about, yeah, the blues. Oh, yeah, and this is the DNA sepia, and it's the first DNA that uses like paint, like I use a brush, and there's there's ink, and those were premiered last week, the Armory, which the David family saw those, and there's seven here, they're 96 by 72. And that's, like these really, I think all work does, but these definitely need to be seen up close. It's like, there's so much going on there, they have no ideas there. That's why I hate computers. I don't hate computers, isn't that true? Yeah, I have a phone in my fucking pocket. Yeah. And then these are, like, this is done at Cranbrook, and this is done last year. I mean, the only difference is the depth and the amount of stuff I know about myself that I discovered on my own. Like,
being a painter and not wanting to have a, I had a career. I saw the sunrise come up every day for 10 years straight, and I had a great time, I tell you. But it was always about the work. Like, more than marriages, unfortunately sometimes more than my first child, and, but everything came around, and, you know, painting and sculpture is an old person's game, is not true anymore. But I like it that I really have something to say about the world in direct context, like in my work. Like, I discover everything through the work. Like when I'm working super well, everything is rolling in my life. And you know, I mean, I don't, like, for me, I don't have bad days. Like, every day is a good day. You know, you gotta work it. So I think I'm gonna turn it over to you guys, and I'll sit down. John, for a nice country boy. No, really. I have two. My baby sisters are in this. Twin sisters are here tonight, and it's very, very interesting. I haven't the work about the house. Our house is one. My two youngest sisters were not born in the house, but they are in the image that I used on the painting. It's totally uncanny. I never used that word before.
That's uncanny.
So, what's happening, y'all?
Yeah, thank you for that. That was incredible.
Thank you.
Yeah. I kind of want to start, go back to the beginning a little bit. I read something I thought was very interesting, that when you decided that you wanted to be an artist, you took up drawing. You did it every day for 2 years, for 40 hours a week.
4 hours a week.
And I think this, like, is indicative of work ethic and labor that is evident in both your artistic process, but also your persistence with painting for the decades you've been doing it. Mm-hmm. Can you talk a little bit more about this approach to your art and life?
Could you say it in, a shorter way?
Yeah, like.
Because I.
Yeah, I think it's interesting to talk a little bit about. Like, work ethic and labor, and how you approach every day, but also in what resides on the surface of your canvas.
Yeah, it kind of goes back to the, you know, first museum I was in, I went into, it was 1966 summer. It was the Museum of Modern Art. And I was I had a job in New York as an associate editor of this new magazine. I was this kid writer, and, you know, I don't know, like, it kind of goes back, because it's the first time I saw a painting. I know painting, of course, but that moment I thought that painting must be of a philosophical nature, and it really intrigued me. And so for me, like, so, and it took me 2 years, I dropped out of school again, went to Europe. It took me 2 years to have enough nerve to take a drawing class, because I'd never drawn before. And so for me, it was always that you had to be more than smart, you had to be more than talent. I mean, talent, you know, is so funny, because everybody goes in a museum and they see something, how did that shit get there? Everybody sees, like, I can do that, shit, you know. Yeah, you know, I'm kind of torn between, like, we don't have a lot of time, and I have some funny stories they might want to hear.
Yeah, sure.
No. But one.
Right.
One story I told my lunch dates this morning. And I'm not gonna tell the story because it's kind of big, but I'm gonna tell another Jean-Michel Basquiat story. Well, aside from that, I was outside when he first gave
I never forget it, I forget his name, the like Henry, like the curator from Mott, the Henry Gelsel, his little work on his back, he gave it to, I was outside the bar with Rene Ricard smoking some weed. But, okay, we become little friends because one of them I've seen at the time, they were good friends, so he would come by our place with his limousine and a pocket full of $100 bills, and we'd go out and have a good time. So his first show was in a big show at the Whitney Museum. It was, it was Binion, I think. Maybe it was probably 81. Yeah, 81. And he sees me, right? I had a hat on, a porcelain hat. It was chocolate brown with red, yellow, and blue stripe. It was like killing. So he sees me, runs up to me. He says, "I'll trade the hat for a painting." I said, "Cool, baby." But my girlfriend had just had it made for my birthday. You know, so I said, "I will see you on Monday." He said, "No, I have to have it now." I still have the hat, so I have a $47 million hat. I mean, I got a story about everybody. Bryce Martin and Mary Boone to everybody. Julian, I mean, you know.
Where would you like to start?
Yeah, I mean, I think you talk about this, like this, the energy and the smallness of New York from the 1970s. I think that's such an interesting story.
Yeah.
Tell us more.
Well, you know, for a kid, I'm finished here in 73, I just turned 27. To be hanging out, like number one, in Soho, it was only three bars. And on Saturday, everybody from, you know, Bob Rauschenberg to Oldenburg, just Rich Sarah, you know, everybody stopped working about noon and came outside and hung out. Like you could stand on the corner of Spring Street and West Broadway for an hour and see everybody in the art world, everybody. And so, you know, like for me, it was like, and also, like they would come to your studio, like people came to my studio and walked up five flights. Like, you know, Paul Cooper and everybody. But the point is that it was a time where dealers, and I hate the word gallerist, dealers were honored to come to your studio. And then it switched around. You know, now you got artists begging people. You know, it's just don't do it. I would use the F word, but I'm not. Them. You know, like, get to work, that's all based on the work, man. Like, the way I got into Venice, it's so much about who I am. It's like, the curator, Christine Marcel from the Pompidou in Paris, comes into the gallery in New York, Gallery Long, and to see someone else's work, and checks my work on the wall, and said, bam. And then she comes to see it three more times, and she calls me, and I'm in. But that's what, for me, it was all about. Let the work speak for itself. The rest of the stuff, I mean, I've had enough fun for five lifetimes, y'all. I had the ball. Man, I know how to party and have fun. Yeah, but, you know, so I don't have to do any of that stuff anymore. But, you know, I was feeling that, you know, and also I talk plenty of trash, I tell you, man. I mean, but a lot of it's, I mean, I don't say anything, I don't talk about anything I don't believe in. You know, it's like there's a few people that are still alive that know how the art world was formed, like because all the things that happens now is like not a parody of, but some kind of fiction of the actual story.
Yeah.
And it's cool because it's really good. I love when artists do really well, you know, because the way I feel. The higher an artist gets, the higher we all get because it raises the margin.
McArthur, can I ask you, yes, you've got some amazing stories. And actually, I would like to go back to the audience and just let you talk and listen to the stories. But New York, you talk often, you did at lunchtime when we've met, about the importance of leaving New York. Mm. The importance of leaving New York and going to Chicago, not because Chicago was what was important, but it was important to leave New York. But could you talk a little bit more about what did you get out of New York? Because it's in your paintings, it's in your address books.
I get.
What did you get? What was New York for the first black MFA from Cranbrook to go there?
I got a real life.
Tell us.
I mean, you know, I'm a social historian in a real serious sense, so, you know, to be able to walk by and hang out on the stoop of all the painters, like Rothko, Apollo, all the places where they lived and the places where they had their girlfriends shacked up and see all kinds of places. But also the main thing is to be living inside the legacy of what happened in New York, and you feel it walking on the street. You can feel it less now because there's been so much. Like, look, it's like, you don't have to be in New York to learn how to be a painter anymore, I don't think.
Right.
But it's still, it's like the possible exposition for juice that was left for you from like previous painters. Because I believe in that. It's like every day I go in the studio, I challenge someone that I admire. Mark Rothko, Cy, Twombly. I have a battle with them. I beat them up.
Then why do you say so often, you said it the very first time we ever met on the years ago, you say a lot in interviews that your painting, it's not from art history. Your painting is philosophical, as you just said to Laura.
Well, but and I discovered the painting was.
Right, you discovered.
And it's in mine is.
Absolutely. So what is it are you getting at then when you say that your painting is not art historical?
My point is that if you can't draw a line to where I am, it just goes like that. It goes like that.
Sure.
So, like, okay, it's like, I think I don't read stuff written by me, but something that someone, my daughter sometimes reads something to me, and someone said something about, maybe it was the interview or the thing you guys did, but something about jazz music. And the truth is that I'm not influenced by jazz music. We come from the same place.
Okay.
So, you know, but let's talk more about your, I'm not answering you. So let me know more.
I mean, I have a question that kind of follows on that. I mean, it's.
You guys got some questions too, right?
Yeah, well, cool. We have time. I mean, you spoke about like Alfredo Lem as being an influence, and that's something George Ortman, who was your professor at Cranbrook, introduced you to. You were very like active with your contemporaries, but that you've talked about being in pursuit of what you called your own homemade geometry. Another quote you had said was that my head doesn't come from art history; I'm a true rural modernist, which I thought was really interesting.
Rural modernist. World?
Rural.
Rural, yeah. Like sometimes, like when one does it for me, when I don't have the information coming in, I can be wherever I want to be, because it's all coming out, and so I have total control of the direction, of how. I'm still not getting.
So you talked about homemade geometry.
Oh, yeah, yeah. But the point is that I'm not trying to make homemade geometry. I am homemade geometry. You know what I'm saying? And that's why I don't come from art history. Look, man, I mean, all these art students, they all know how to draw and stuff, and they know all this stuff. It's like, you know, it's like, for me, it's like, I have to tell you another story. No, I fought it. I went to Europe, and I was 1504 being a writer. And what happened is that until I was 19 years old, I had a speech block. I only stutter now. But what happened was that when you have a speech block, it was all about I developed how to listen. Like it also be, I was the most popular person in my school. So, and I couldn't talk. So it's like this nonverbal communication. So therefore, painting came to me I saw that much later on. But it took me, because I'm the kind of person that when I get involved in something, I'm in it forever. So, and I'm looking at Lila Silverman, and her husband was so critical to my career. He was so supportive, and I loved Gil. Yeah, man. It's like it's a good like when I come to art history, I'm kind of like I know art history and all that stuff. I'm not there. I could read.
So then, tell us what do you mean when you say you're not there?
I'm painting about it. Like me, you know, like I'm not shy as you know by now, but you know, but language. I have difficulty with language. It's like. I know the Queen's language really well and all that stuff, but you know, it's not icky language or anything. But you know,
so when you're painting, let's go back to the jazz.
Sure.
For example, you say that it's not that jazz influences you as a painter.
We're from the same place.
We're from the same place, yeah. And I do think there is an extraordinary musical quality to your work. So what is the place? What is the place that you're in? Can you, you know,
I'm making it up. Painting. I'm making it up, man.
Sure.
So I mean, like, once I define it, it stops it.
Okay.
And so I don't want to stop it. So I will talk better about this when I stop working every day in a couple of years.
Are you planning on stopping? I didn't think you could stop painting.
No, I'm not going to stop painting, but I have certain goals that will happen within a couple of years, and I'll be able to like travel. And I'm very interested in supporting young artists because no cities in America support young artists. So I want to like focus some time to promoting young artists like around the country and particularly in Detroit. So you know, I'm like, you know, I'm not going to retire from painting. I mean, like you're crazy. Not now, for sure.
I can't imagine it.
But you know, I love talking to Michael because he's super smart. Like, but also, it's a like I said some thing to say, and you know, I'm thinking like, is this the right audience? But Michael is the first black male curator I've ever known.
Not true.
It's true. I know some names and shit. And he's super smart and he understands the work and we're developing a really good dialogue. And so for me, like, I don't share anything. I'm trying to share a little bit tonight, but you know, I'm not afraid of sharing, but every time I share big, I lose two paintings, man. So for me to give it up to the students here, I probably lost three paintings today. And also, that's my daughter's 4 years tuition. So, you know.
All right, let's open this up.
Yeah.
Yeah. Who has a question?
Nobody has a question, cool. Yeah. The what? Louder. I was born down south. It seems like they came into work.
That came into the work a little later after Cranbrook. I was wondering the things that you were exploring in Cranbrook. I was trying to find your thesis for the
literature. Like someone stole it, or the school destroyed it because it was too short. I don't know.
So the young man was just saying he was looking for MacArthur's thesis.
Yeah. Written thesis.
But couldn't find it. In the context of the question, when did the South, where MacArthur was born in Mississippi, started to enter the work?
Oh, you know, it took me 15 years to figure out how to use my phone book. So it's really slow, and to be able to feel comfortable emotionally dealing with like real crucial autobiographicalness. Like, first of all, like I confide in you, I cry a lot in the studio. It's like joy. It's like pain a little, but it's joy. And, you know, it's like, if I knew all that stuff, if I knew exactly why, I would be Richard Prince or somebody. And I'm not using him because I hate him or anything. I don't even know him. but the point is that, you know, I want to be that person that still is still trying to make a good painting, man, like I was here. I mean, I'm only me. I didn't talk to people here, man. I mean, I was just trying to learn how to be a painter. Like most people that are here been making art way long. I started making art as I was 22 years old, man. So I came here 3 years later. I kicked ass to get here. Like 3 years I became an artist from scratch, you know. And that's like perseverance, working. But I learned as a child that's about hard work. I don't care how smart you are. Because smart ain't special no more, as I've told my children. You have to come with some character, some kind of gift that you can give, and not like, yeah. You know. So again, for me, it was like discovering. I just think the more, this is sound corny, but the more you clearly know about who you are, you'll be able to to trust your instinct, you know, in terms of painting. But you know, like getting back to New York in the 1970s, everybody around the world, every smart person from every little town in the world came there. So it was this whole big a ball of like energy, and everybody was invited, and it was like open. Like you could every Saturday. I mean, you could walk into a party in Seoul. I mean, big time famous people now. They had open parties of the level of like life trust, you know, something. But it was like for a kid, it was like so inspiring. I want to like really join that, and also. Like, I take painting in the studio every day as a heavyweight amateur bout, every day. I don't mess around with that. And so, for me, that came from, like, walking the streets of New York and wanting to compete at a very young age with, you know, people like Dan Flavin, who were my friends. Right. And having that kind of work ethic and knowing the only way you get there is by hard work, or you have some kind of a really hot career in your 30s, and by the time you're 55, you're really, really, really famous and broke, and you can't make any way. No, I wasn't going to be that person. So for me, I said no early on because they wanted me to be the only black person. But instead, they got my friend Jean-Michel.
So you're saying Jean-Michel was burnt out?
Burnt out. He was 27 years old. They like used him like, you know, I mean, you know. I mean, he's a kid. I mean, how much do you know at age 27? I don't care who you are. Mm-hmm. It's just not possible.
So what made it possible for you to survive?
Just hard work and just sure. I mean, I'm a super hard person.
I think you're a teddy bear.
But you know what? The real teddy bears are secretly hard as steel. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, baby. No, I'm having a really good time here. Okay. I'm kind of just getting started though.
audience over here, stand up.
Hi there.
Hey.
So I've been enjoying your talk so far.
Cool.
Question or maybe advice for artists who run into a point where maybe they're not feeling like they can create. How do you get over the blockage to
like I don't leave. I just take a recess, darling. I don't leave. No, you can't leave because you leave, you lose your stuff. I mean, because you got to gain it back. I mean, I've had times, like I don't have bad days. I just don't. Like I wasn't raised that way. And so, like every day is a profit. Like if you see the world that way. So. if you're having a block or something, you gotta, I don't know what to do because you gotta put that first and you gotta put everything, it's like, I don't really know the answer because I don't, but it's really up to you to really push hard and work like a dog. I call myself a work dog. I work hard. I work better than anybody working. I know it. It's really funny. And I really anticipated that the question about the jazz music, but where it comes from. The point is that I don't know yet, but the only time I'll listen to music in the last 5 years are by people I personally know. Like Ornette Coleman, I knew Ornette Coleman and Don Cherry, Butch Morris, Henry Threadgill, like Sadiq Bey, and then, and so that keeps it, but the only time I listened last year was when Ornette died, so I listened for a day. But, I just think that, the more information you take in, the more you have to, fight it, battle it, because it's not yours. So for me, it's really hard not listening to music and not reading anything. But I think that, I want to make a contribution. I really want to move it along. I could get more specific, but it's the wrong audience.
This audience. Any other?
Well, I could be candid with the audience, right?
Sure.
Okay.
Yeah, of course.
All right.
You've been holding back?
Yeah. No. I mean, this is really big for me. And it's a challenge that I set up for myself a long time ago. It's not like rural modernist. I sometimes see myself living in a little, from the outside, it looks like this little plane, but it's this fabulous studio in some, in fact, I just bought a property in a country country property outside of 90 miles outside of Chicago, and I can walk, it's 18 acres, and so I'm kind of like, I didn't start out wanting to say that.
You were going to start being candid.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Modernism.
The reason, for me, I'm in it for the race. It's not race. I'm in it for the race. Like when you think about modernism and you look at it, you say, okay, Paul Sanzang got something to get started. But when you look at the reality of it, it's a painting by Picasso called L'Avignon Damoiselle, whatever it's called.
Damoiselle
d'Avignon. That painting is so critical to modernism, right? It's African mask. I'm sorry, Pablo, I love you, but this little dude, I'm dealing with Palma because let's take, and then you take it to my oldest daughter's godfather, Romare Bearden. Here's a person that was influenced by himself. I love Romy, I think it's great. But, so those kind of things I'm after in a, and that's real confidence, because I don't talk about that, because it's really big. And you can't talk about race comfortably with all my white friends' audience. It's just not the shit to do. It's just dumb. And so, but the point is...
You said you wanted to be candid.
Yeah. I can go further now, y'all.
They're waiting,
Well, that's the same. We got some time. No. No, but really, getting self-conscious.
So what is your critique of modernism? Could you talk about...
I don't know about it, really.
You don't see your work as just modernist.
No.
Right?
Mine is easy. No. It's easy. Like, hey, guys, have you noticed, like, if something happened in the 70s, there's this thing called, which I never understood.
Appropriation?
No. Well, appropriation. Don't get me started.
Okay.
Appropriation. Well. Number one, I'm old and I'm working long enough to appropriate myself. So appropriation. No. Guys. Look.
look, you look, if you notice that in the 80s, there was this thing came out called conceptual art. And I'm thinking like, okay, all those guys went to art school, and this is really cool, because I have a lot of my good friends, but they weren't very good painters or sculptors. And so, and the same thing about a performance art. All those people have like painting and sculpting background, and here's this brown person, 27-year-old in New York, right in the middle of it. And that's where I learned about how to paint.
Right.
About put your guts in there, man. If not, you're not in the game. You know, I mean, you know, I gotta tell you, it's fun making a lot of money now because I got very, very expensive kids. Yeah, so it's really cool, but right now, yeah. I mean, Reed College. But yeah, first of all, I'm gonna come back to the students. This would have never happened if I hadn't gone to Cranbrook.
Sure.
George, like when I was introduced to the work of Wilfredo Lam, I never heard of him. I wasn't influenced by him. His work. I'm influenced by who he was as a human being. Pablo Picasso took Wilfredo, and because Wilfredo was like everything that Picasso imagined he was, you know, because Wilfredo was Cuban, Spanish. It was like, and Picasso, like he wanted to be black or something, because he's like, so all these things. So for me, what motivates me is like, okay, I want to get to a place where I can have my message clearly, like executed. Because
right.
You know, I think most people that teach, they lie, not purposely necessarily, but they say things to students that they don't really know. You know, and it.
Professor, do you have a retort?
No, I'm specifically talking about visual arts professors.
Really?
So, but you know, for me, it was always like I challenged every professor like I ever had because I thought that was my job. You know, to try to like beat the professor down. I mean, like I want even my students to tell me you're fucking wrong, man. Tell me this ain't good. You know, something, I don't know. But yeah, yes, ma'am. Well, you know.
How do you know?
Like, I'm not getting the question totally, but would you translate for your wife, please?
How do you, when a student has got it?
Okay, I get it.
What is it that they've got? How do you recognize it?
What?
Watch it work out?
No. I haven't really had students. I'm not a student. I taught at an open admission school. If you have a GED, you go to school, man. I taught there because you go to any art school in America and fine arts, you might see one black student. So for me, I went to a school that I could really, like all the black, and my generation after, the best black minds went to medical school and law school. This is some boring stuff, but it's true. You know, I want to be a doctor, you know, that's cool. But, you know, so I was trying to recognize and support the young black minds that are all of are pushed toward majoring in design or fashion because there's no jobs in here. Like I said this before, you have to want to do this for nothing forever and enjoy it because otherwise you're not gonna make good art. But you gotta enjoy it making art just because it's what you do. It's like you have no choice. Yeah, for some reason I'm looking right at this woman right there. It's like, yo, you're right on my level. Boom. And there's Lila and there's Bev, man. I can tell you, I'm having a ball.
Okay.
I'm having a good time, man.
Any questions?
One last question.
No, we've got time, don't we?
No, I don't.
Okay.
He's having a ball.
Right here. I'm having a ball. Right. Go, darling. Cool, babe. I love that. Yeah, man. But and then in many is great. I just want to say there was something else I wrote down which I didn't get to. Circular answer, smart isn't special no more. I mean, I really.
I made myself.
Oh yeah. The last thing I'm gonna say, but. Can I see your glasses? Can you read that? No. You have to commit. Okay. Are these, will these work?
They've
oh, jeez. Oh! No, you get. Okay, yeah.
Commitment years.
Reward. Is this
your writing? Yeah. You might write it. Okay. I'll say two things to students. You have to commit, I said kind of before, but this is more clear. You have to commit to 60 years. And the only reward being doing the work. And you know, and that gets to somebody's question, kind of your question, somebody's question. You know, I made myself up. Bang. All right, y'all. Thank you.
Let's party, y'all.